Hey guys, welcome to all of you on our channel, that is Achieve IAS. So friends, as you know that on our channel we are targeting the exam of civil services, and for that purpose we have started multiple series on our channel that target your prelims as well as mains. So in this video we will be talking about our current affair MCQ series, in which what we do, we daily discuss current affairs from your we discuss MCQs from your current affair perspective. And today is 7 October, so let's see what are the questions of the day. So the first question is, consider the following statements related to Petroleum and Explosive Safety Organization. First, it is headquartered in Nagpur. Second, it is under the control of Ministry of Commerce and Industry. So we have to choose that which of the above statements is correct. Let me tell you friends that both of these statements are correct. Answer is C, both 1 and 2. So Petroleum and Explosive Safety Organization, formerly Department of Explosives, with its head office at Nagpur, had completed its 100 years in on 9 September 1998. So it comes under Ministry of Commerce and Industry, Department of Promotion of Industry and International Trade, Government of India. And your second question is, consider the following statements related to Bonnet Macau. First, Macau, or you can call it anyway. First is, it is its IUCN red list status is least concern. Second is, it is endemic to southern India. So we have to choose that which of these statements are correct. Let me tell you friend that both of these statements are correct. So answer here again is C, that is both 1 and 2. So let's see the explanation. So it is an old world monkey. Diurnal animal is endemic to southern India, found only in peninsular India with close proximity to humans. So it exists as commensals to human, meaning it maintains commensalism with human beings. So one organism benefits from the other without affecting it in commensalism. And the study suggested that rhesus macaws were invading the bonnets habitats in south India. So rhesus macaws are usually found in northern part of India. So decrease in tree cover, loss of contiguous canopies, and rapid urbanization causes bonnets disappearance from temples and tourist spots. So now let's move on to the next question. Next is, consider the following statements related to Citizenship Amendment Act 1955. First statement is, a person need to reside in India for 11 years before applying for citizenship through naturalization. Second, section 6A was added to accommodate provisions of Assam Accord. So we have to choose that which of these statements is correct. Let me tell you friends, again both these statements are correct. So the answer is C. So the more detail you can find in your Citizenship Amendment Act your Indian Polity by Lakshmi Kant. And this Assam Accord question has been asked because this question is in we can say this topic is in news from quite long time due to NRC exercise taken up in Assam. Now let's say Nitakat law seen in news is related to which nation? A, Iran, B, Malaysia, C, Saudi Arabia, D, Iraq. So friends, the solution is C. So Nitakat is basically Saudization program introduced by Saudi Ministry of Labor. So enacted in 2011, Nitakat law makes it mandatory for all businesses in the private sector to reserve at least 10% of jobs for Saudi nationals. So it makes it mandatory for local companies to hire one Saudi national for every 10 migrant workers. So based on their compliance, establishments are characterized into blue, green, yellow and red groups. So blue and green businesses having the highest localization ratios, and they are rewarded for compliance. And then there is yellow falling in intermediate range. They are given more time to implement the changes, and red is for the least compliant, and companies in red zone are under pressure to comply. So therefore Nitakat law aims to gradually replace the existing expatriate workers with Saudi workers by processes involving quotas and threats of punishment, and also tackles the issue of rising unemployment through among Saudi nationals. So this is about your fourth question. Now let's move on to the fifth question. Fifth question is, S-400 Triumph missile system seen in news belongs to which country? So friends, A, Russia, B, India, C, US, D, China. So answer is Russia. So recently India has procured this air defense missile system, so S-400. So the agreement to purchase a missile system, it boosted the India-Russia defense ties at a point of inflection in 2018. So Russia has traditionally been India's biggest defense supplier, but was surpassed by the US in the last few years, a fact that had added to the perceptible drift in bilateral ties. Both the leaders addressed this drift with a special reset summit in Sochi, which was followed by Mr. Putin's visit to Delhi when the deal was announced. So Indian Air Force has also backed this superior air defense system in that it will fill the gap in India's particular needs, countering its main adversaries and neighbors China and Pakistan's growing air power while dealing with a depleting stock of fighter aircraft. So Pakistan has over 20 fighter squadrons with upgraded F-16s and inducting J-17 from China in large number. So China has 1700 fighters, including 800 fourth generation fighters. So there is a shortfall of fighter squadrons, and it has fairly affected Indian Air Force effort to pose a challenge to the enemies. So is India the only country facing cuts or sections? Because this has been in news, because India was of cautious that it doesn't come under the CARTS Act, that is countering America's adversary through sanctions act, because it brought this S-400 Triumph missile system from Russia. So by coincidence, CARTS has now been invoked by United Nations twice already, and both times for countries buying the Triumph system from Russia. So in September 2018, US State Department and Treasury Department announced sanctions on China's Equipment Development Department. So this is basically a military branch for the procurement, and it procured S-400 Triumph air defense system and Sukhoi S-35 fighter aircraft. So sanctions were triggered by when People's Liberation Army took delivery of the systems. So Washington expelled Turkey from F-35 fighter jet program in July 2019 after the first delivery of S-400s was received, and says sanctions are still under consideration unless Turkey reverses its deal with Russia. So sanction waiver, this is question that whether India would be, we can say, would be granted a sanction waiver under this. So exit clause in CARTS states that the US president may waive the application of CARTS sanctions if the president determines that such a waiver is in national security interest of United States. So in 2018, US Congress also modified the waiver clause to allow the president to certify that a country is cooperating with the United States government on other matters that are critical to United States strategic national security interests. So then government officials, including Foreign Secretary Vijay Gokhale, National Security Advisor Ajit Doval, and Mr. Jay Shankar have all expressed the hope that the US will exercise this waiver for the S-400 deal to India for a number of reasons. So these are the reasons: that a militarily stronger India is in US interest, because you can see that China is the rise of China. And then also, India cannot completely drop its traditional dependence on the Russian defense equipment without being weakened. So what happens if a waiver is not granted? Then obviously sanctions, punitive sanctions will be there under the section 235. There are 12 kinds of sanctions. So president may impose 5 or more of the sanctions described. None of these is expected to go into presence until India takes the delivery of these 5 S-400 systems, which it has paid an advance on, so which are expected to begin in about 20 months and conclude by 2023. So implications are many, so you can read about it. So it is quite lengthy discussion, you can say explanation. Now let's move on to the next question. Consider the following statements related to bamboo. First, India is home to Asia's oldest bamboo. Second, they are not considered as trees on private land under the Indian Forest Act 1927. So which of the above statements is correct? Let me tell you, friends, that both of these statements are again correct. So the answer is both 1 and 2. So international team of researchers found that two fossil compressions or impressions of bamboo culms. So they were named bamboo sicculmus therapensis and B. macumensis, as they were found in the Therap mine of Macum coalfield in Assam. So details are more, you can read about them. This is about your sixth question. Now let's move on to the next question. Next is, consider the following statements related to CRISPR-Cas9 system. First, it is gene editing technique used in biotechnology sector. Second, this technique is derived from bacterial immune system against viral infection. So we have to choose that which of the above statements is correct. Let me tell you, friends, that both of these statements are correct. So yes, it is a gene editing technique. It is used in biotechnology sector, and this sector is a drive. This technique is derived from bacterial immune system against your viral infection. So CRISPR-Cas9 is basically the clustered regularly interspaced short palindromic repeats, or CRISPR is basically the elaborate form of this, and it has revolutionized the genetic manipulations that made genetic editing simpler and faster, so and easily accessible to most laboratories. So it is basically a gene editing technology that can be used for the purpose of altering genetic expression or changing the genome of an organization. So it can be used for targeting specific stretches of an entire genetic code or editing the DNA at particular locations. So it is a simple but yet powerful tool for editing genomes. It also allows researchers to easily alter DNA sequences and modify the gene function. So its potential implications or applications include correcting genetic defects, treating and preventing the spread of diseases, and improving crops. So however, its promise also raises ethical concerns. So it is basically a cut and paste mechanism. So where a particular, suppose a particular genetic code is, we can say, expected to cause complications in the organism, then that particular portion is cut, and here CRISPR-Cas9 is basically the good protein is pasted there. So specific location of genetic codes that need to be changed, they are edited, is identified on the DNA strand, and then using the Cas9 protein, which acts like a pair of scissors, that location is cut off from the strand, and DNA strand when broken has a natural tendency to repair itself. So sorry, I'm wrong in the starting. It is not pasted up some DNA is pasted here, but also then it can also repair itself. So scientists intervene during this auto repair process, applying the desired sequence of genetic codes that binds itself with broken DNA strand. So concerns are that tampering with the genetic code in human beings is more contentious. So leading scientists in the field have for long been calling for a global pause on clinical applications of the technology in human beings until the internationally accepted protocols are developed. So issues are that study by Stanford University, US, found that CRISPR-Cas9 system introduces unexpected off-target, so outside the intended editing site's effects in mice. So fear is that it is being prematurely rushed for clinical use lingers. So three recent reports have exacerbated this fear even further. So studies have highlighted that CRISPR-Cas9 edited cells might trigger cancer. So this is a big problem, obviously. Then there is also risk of mutations elsewhere in the genome in those cells, because obviously this is a technology. So there might be possibility of off target, and obviously and genetic changes appear. They take a quite long time to appear themselves. And themselves to make themselves, we can say, express. So in that context, that is also an issue, and it has been successfully used to cure several diseases, but it remains that many things are not clear, that how we should determine which disease or traits are appropriate for gene editing. So ethical concerns are that manipulation may take place. So for example, if a simple example is that if parents want intelligent child, and they think that the scientists tell that okay, if we do the genetic editing, that the child can be intelligent, or we can say looking beautiful, then obviously they will say that we will cut off this strand, and in that place we will install other strand, and that will make the features look like this. So that is, there is an issue of commercialization, and then there is also issue of ethical concerns are also there. So you can read about it. Many editorials are there about it. So you can search on the internet. Next is, Goa Maritime Conclave is organized by Army, Air Force, Navy, Coast Guard. So let me tell you, friend, that the answer is C. That is, solution is C. So Goa Maritime Conclave is organized by Navy. So it hosted the second edition by 10 Indian attended by 10 Indian littoral states and observers from a few friendly foreign countries. So details are that it was set up in 2017 to identify common threats in Indian Ocean region and thus in the process evolve cooperative mechanisms to tackle them. So theme for the conclave is common maritime priorities in Indian Ocean region and need for regional maritime strategy. So you can obviously see from the theme that basically maritime priorities that are common, they have to be identified, and need for regional maritime strategy is the focus to be, which is to be developed. So the conclave focused on capacity building among Indian Ocean region navies to tackle the emerging maritime threats, in addition to discussing cooperative strategies for enhancing interoperability among partner maritime agencies. So intelligence sharing is part of it concerning terrorism and drugs and trafficking, and then that piracy related problems, that all these fall under its ambit. Now let's move to the next question. Next is Mount Vesuvius is in which country? A. Indonesia, B. Italy, C. Malaysia, D. Spain. So friends, answer is B, that is Italy. So it is a Somma strato volcano located on the Gulf of Naples in Campania, Italy. So it is considered as world's most dangerous volcanoes, one of the most dangerous volcanoes, and is the only active volcano on Europe's mainland. So please note the word Europe's mainland. So Mount Vesuvius erupted in AD 79 and it had destroyed the towns of Pompeii and Herculaneum. So context is that ancient scrolls charred by Vesuvius could be read once again with the help of US scientists who are working on deciphering words using new X-ray technique. So this was the news in yesterday's newspaper, The Hindu. Now let's move to the next question. Next is, consider the following statements related to green tractors. First, it has been developed by Council of Scientific and Industrial Research. Second is the commonly used pollution causing chemicals, aluminium, barium, potassium, nitrate and carbon, have either been removed or sharply reduced in the green cracker. So which of the statements is correct? Let me tell you friends that both of these statements are correct. Yes, they are developed by Council of Scientific and Industrial Research, that is CSIR. And then this commonly used pollution causing chemicals have been significantly reduced or eliminated. So Supreme Court in October 2018 banned the sale, use and manufacture of crackers that weren't green to reduce the pollution levels, as firecrackers played a major role in exacerbating it. So then this initiative is now in a bid to resolve the crisis of air pollution. The government has launched these green firecrackers. So this meant that these crackers couldn't be allowed beyond a certain limit, had to be approved by the Petroleum and Explosives Safety Organization, and had to be free of mercury, arsenic and barium. So the court also restricted the time by which these have to be burst on Deepavali. So however, compliant crackers weren't able in the available in the market. So now green crackers have been developed. So they are less dangerous and less harmful to the atmosphere, and they are environment friendly fireworks, such as sound emitting crackers, flower pots, pencils, chakra and sparkles. So significance is it can reduce particulate matter pollution by 30%, so it is a quite large number. And then on explosion, they reduce the dust and smoke typically associated with crackers by 30%, and also decrease sulfur oxide and nitrous oxide emissions by 20%. So these crackers cause the same as the older and are significantly greener. So green logo has well as quick response coding system has been developed for differentiation of green crackers from conventional crackers. So QR code is a novel feature incorporated on the firecrackers to avoid manufacturing and sale of counterfeit products. So this will help the customers to track the cracker using smartphones and other devices. And this will also protect the livelihood of millions of people engaged in the manufacturing and sale of fireworks across the country. But the challenges are that cracker manufacturers say that they aren't sure if they will be able to supply and manufacture in sufficient quantities in 2019, and it is too short a time for before Deepavali to manufacture and release them in the market. So certainly as of now, if we see this Diwali, then it may seem that it is not achievable, but there certainly by next festival season, that is next Diwali, certainly there will be, the production will increase. So then they can be expected to we can say capture the market. So such type of questions are important for you, because obviously science and technology is a part of your syllabus, and they such kind of innovations help you, we can say, understand the importance of the science and technology. And you can cite such examples that such type of things are developed, being developed by the government, and it is one of the measures that are being taken by the government to reduce the problem of air pollution, because in India the problem is quite we can say quite large. So this is all about, friends, today's discussion. Nearly 20 minutes have passed, but the discussion was so lengthy because questions were interesting and their explanation as well was interesting. So if you like the discussion, if you like the video, if you like the MCQs, if you like the explanation, if you liked my voice, my sweet voice, then do ensure that you like it, share it with your friends, and also ensure that you subscribe to our channel. And lastly, friends, the link of the link of our public Telegram channel is shown on your screen. So this on this Telegram channel we have more than 13,000 subscribers that are associated with us, and they remain updated about our various initiatives that we are running for the purpose of CSE 2020. So if in case you are interested to remain updated with our initiatives and want to avail our public services, then you are more than welcome to join this Telegram channel. So lastly, friends, if you have any doubts and queries, you can ask in the comment box. If you don't want to ask in the comment box, then you can mail us at achieveias21@gmail.com, or you can also contact us at 8968920720. So this is all about, friends, today's discussion. And lastly, friends, we also have a website you can visit on this website, where we keep on updating our various initiatives that we have for the purpose of preparation. And lastly, also, friends, if you want the PDFs of these MCQs, then do ensure that you check the description box, because the subscription link is given in the description box. So obviously there is a minimum fee for it, and that is ₹99 per month, and that has been kept for the purpose of our motivation, so that we people can remain motivated to help you people. So if in case you are interested to get the PDFs, then do ensure that you check the description box. So this is all about today's video. Thank you. Have a very nice day ahead.